What's going on, guys? This is Rob, and if you're enjoying the content that I'm uploading onto my channel, then feel free to subscribe, and you can also offer suggestions on topics and characters and storylines and whatnot that we can have discussions on later on in this channel. Okay, so getting into Spider Island, what I wanted to do was just go ahead and throw this prologue in here anyway in this video. And the reason why is just because of the fact that there are a few things here in this prologue that will be important with regards to the story. Not insane, not anything that we could like go without talking about. I mean, we could just cover it in the rest of the video, but I wanted to go ahead and just throw it in here anyway because it can't hurt. It beefs up the video. And it's never a bad thing. But the cool thing is that for the most part, when it comes to Spider-Man in this prologue, it's really just kind of like his goings on. It's really just like, here's what Spider-Man does when he does things. But it's also kind of Dan Slott saying, hey guys, there are some things going on in the background that at first don't seem relevant, but become relevant later on. Specifically, some guys who have committed some robberies. Now, the reason these guys committing these robberies is because they've become more brazen. With these Spider-Man powers, while they don't necessarily manifest right off the bat, they are becoming a little more adventurous. They are becoming a little more dangerous than they normally would be. Because for them, they kind of feel like they're indestructible, you know, just because of the fact that they basically have the same abilities as Spider-Man. Now, these criminals are wrapped up by Peter Parker pretty fast. And of course, he just kind of races off just because of this New York. There's always a crime going on somewhere. And so for Peter Parker, he can't just linger around. It's just kind of like, okay, these guys are wrapped up. You know, the cops are here. We'll call it a day. I got to bail out. Now, the cool thing about this is we also pick up with J. Jonah Jameson. Now, keep in mind, Jameson's currently mayor of New York. The issue with this is that his approval ratings are at an all-time low. And the reason why is because he hates Spider-Man. And he makes no bones about the fact that he hates Spider-Man. Now, under normal circumstances, this wouldn't be a problem, but everybody in the city loves Spider-Man, and so they hate the mayor because he hates Spider-Man. It's just one of these funny little situations, but it's also J. Jonah Jameson on the other side of the coin, on the other side of the line, in the sense that when he was running the Daily Bugle, he was going through and just lambasting Spider-Man all the time. You know, Spider-Man sucks, Spider-Man's a menace, so on and so forth. It's one of the things that we loved about his character. Well, now the Daily Bugle is running these campaigns against J. Jonah Jameson. And so now he's like, well, I don't like being on the other side. It's not fair. You know, the Daily Bugle is wrong. It's just one of these things where it's like, be damned with the facts. My opinion's right. But again, you know, a lot of this is just kind of Peter doing his own thing. It's him just kind of, you know, being a hero and doing whatever it is that he does in his normal time. But one of these funny little moments that we get is in Horizon Labs. And that's why I really like Dan Slott's writing, because it's just the funny little moments that make the story so interesting. With an experiment that he's basically, you know, showing to Max Modell and the rest of the guys at Horizon Labs, Max Modell makes the comment that you can't tack the number 2000 to the end of something and it becomes cooler, which I beg to differ. Like, imagine Comics Explained 2000, like explaining comics to you in the voice of Morgan Freeman. Like, it'd be pretty funny. It'd be kind of cool. But it's just one of those funny little moments. I mean, nothing too major. But with regards to the whole lead up, with regards to this being like a tried and true prologue to the whole element of Spider Island, this is when we start to see people manifesting abilities. This comes in a couple different forms. The first is through Carly Cooper. The whole idea with Carly is that while she's currently on the scene of this crime, remember, she's a forensic scientist, she watches a couple of these criminals break free of their webbing. This is something that should normally never be allowed to happen. The webbing is designed to easily, you know, keep a normal human being contained. The only individuals that can break out of Peter Parker's webbing are people with super strength. And so this is Dan Slott saying their spider powers are starting to emerge. They're basically gaining the abilities of Spider-Man. Now, in response to this, Carly Cooper immediately takes out one of these guys. And this is Dan Slott telling us Carly Cooper now has super strength. And that's the way this really begins to unfold, is that these small little glimpses, these small little drops here and there of people gaining all these different abilities. Now, from here, we pick up with the Jackal, and we pick up with the Jackal's henchman. Now, again, at this point, we don't really know who this henchman is. All we know is that he's just a guy that's there with the Jackal. And what Jackal does is he presents a card to one of these people, one of these individuals who've developed spider powers, and says, be at this location tomorrow. And so the idea is that there's a kind of gathering of sorts. What the Jackal will do with that, we don't quite know yet. But again, switching over to the Future Foundation, keep in mind, all of this comes after Hickman's Fantastic Four. So because of that, Peter Parker is still part of the Future Foundation. That's still very much a role that he plays, you know, this kind of scientific community. And it works out for his character, because with Peter Parker as part of Future Foundation and as part of Horizon Labs, it means he has access to all the science concepts that the Future Foundation is coming up with under Reed Richards, the smartest man in the Marvel Universe, and he can extend those to Horizon Labs. So while I wouldn't say that he's a double agent, it does allow him to cheat a little bit. It does allow him to basically grab ideas that may not necessarily be his own that he's helped to contribute to, and then roll them over into Horizon Labs. But the issue with this is that while all this is happening, individuals from around New York are manifesting spider powers. They're manifesting spider abilities. Now, the effects of this are wild. wide and ranging. I mean, you know, some people are only developing a spider sense and the powers come, you know, the strength and speed come later. Some people are developing strength and speed and the spider sense comes later. But they're all having these kind of physical reactions. And so to the doctors of New York, there's some kind of virus that's going around that's infecting the city on a massive scale, and no one quite knows how to handle it. Now, at this point, we pick up with the Jackal again, and we have him back in his laboratory, of course, you know, where he's continuing to experiment. And we basically have this woman who's in shadow. Now, we'll find out who she is, and it's actually going to be Dan Slott returning and then killing off an old character from from Spider-Man's, really like the holdover of old Spider-Man stories. But what we find out is that someone's basically been kidnapped by the Jackal, and this person is being experimented on for the purpose of serving, you know, some kind of role, some kind of, you know, I guess maybe being a powerhouse member of Jackal's group. But we also find out this unknown henchman of Jackal is Kane. Now, this is really, really interesting, because when it came to the character of Kane in Marvel Comics, Kane Parker, he made his debut in Web of Spider-Man number 119, I think, and he was basically part of Clone Saga, the story everybody hates. But the idea is that Kane was kind of like this holdover from Clone Saga that Marvel just never really knew how to get rid of. It was like Marvel's dirty little secret. Like, what do you do with a character like Kane? I mean, after Clone Saga, like, there was nothing for him. He was just kind of tumbling down the rabbit hole of stories and popping up every once in a while and just becoming increasingly irrelevant as time went on. And so by the time it got around to Spider Island, this is probably the most significant role that he plays, leading into him becoming the second Scarlet Spider with Scarlet Spider Volume 2. That story is amazing, by the way. I love Scarlet Spider with Kane Parker. And I don't know how other people feel about it, but I always thought it was really, really enjoyable. But we basically have this giant spider guy kind of manifesting, but we also find out that this unknown woman's able to basically seize control of this spider guy. You know, whoever this giant, you know, monster is, she's able to seize control of it and bend it to her will. And so from here, we basically pick up with this revelation that everybody in New York is developing spider powers. They're able to shoot webbing. They have super strength. They have super speed. They can crawl on walls. They basically have all the abilities of Spider-Man. But for the life of Peter Parker, for his own individual goings-on, Carly Cooper reveals the fact that she has Spider-Man's powers. Now, this is crazy. This is really, really interesting, because what she does is she kind of tries to corner him a little bit, right? And say, hey, look, like, you're friends with Spider-Man. Like, you make all his gear. Because remember, that's kind of been the ongoing lie that Peter Parker's been telling everybody that begins to get close to the idea that he's Spider-Man. He basically says, well, no, I'm not Spider-Man. It's just I helped to develop Spider-Man's gear, you know, all his different gadgets and all that kind of good stuff. I helped him build that. And so that's the lie that Carly Cooper's been told, and it's the lie that she believes. And so in response, her idea is, hey, look, like, help me out. Like, have me, you know, let me meet with Spider-Man so that we can start working together and he can teach me how to be a superhero. And that seems to be a lot of people's response to this. A lot of people seem to have this idea that they all want to be superheroes. Not only that, we end up meeting up with Miles Warren. We end up meeting up with the Jackal, where he basically passed this note on to this guy, as well as a multitude of other people, show up at this location at a certain time. And the idea of Miles Warren is to cause absolute chaos, cause absolute pandemonium in Bryant Park in New York by giving everyone who's there some variation of the Spider-Man costume. And all these costumes range from the earliest costumes that Peter Parker wore when he was Spider-Man to just, you know, costumes you can buy off the shelves, all the way up to his future Foundation costume. And so it's again, no one really knows who Spider-Man is, which Spider-Man is the right Spider-Man. Now, of course, you have Aunt May, you have J. Jonah Jameson Sr. They're heading out to Boston, or at least they're sitting in an airport. They're not in New York right now. Remember, we had talked about that with regards to the whole prelude thing, it was the idea of basically ushering them out, removing them from the landscape and sort of shifting them away. That was the whole basis behind this. And so because of that, with all these different folks unfolding, all these different folks popping up with these, you know, Spider-Man powers, the Avengers, the new Avengers, the mighty Avengers, everybody in New York begins to respond. Now, of course, this begs the question, where's like Excalibur at from Britain? I guess they're just kind of like, well, that ain't our problem. That's New York. We don't care. I have no idea. But the cool thing is that when Peter Parker gets here, it's exactly what we would expect. I mean, you've got guys who are wearing the Iron Spider armor from Civil War, people who are wearing like the Spider-Man Back in Black suit. You know, you have people who are wearing the Spider-Man suit with the wings, you know, people who are wearing the, you know, again, the earliest versions. Every single costume that Spider-Man's ever worn exists in some form or fashion in all these people who have his outfit, so that when the real Peter Parker shows up, no one knows it's him. No one believes it's him. And that's kind of the crazy thing here. That's what made Spider Island so interesting in the beginning, was because Peter Parker's blessing turned out to be his curse. Remember, in Amazing Spider-Man number 641, following the events of Civil War, that Doctor Strange, or at least it had been revealed, that Doctor Strange had cast a spell at the request of Peter Parker that removed knowledge of his identity from the world when he unmasked himself during Civil War in order to lend credence to Tony Stark's claim that if superheroes came forward, they registered, that their secret identities would be safe, that their families would be safe, that following the Civil War event, Marvel had to find some way to put the genie back in the bottle again. And so that's exactly what happened. Dr. Strange said, okay, everybody, no one knows the identity of Peter Parker. The only way they can find out is if Peter Parker basically reveals it to them directly. That's the only way, or if they just happen to see him without his mask or something along those lines. But the issue is that when he shows up, the Avengers, the Mighty Avengers, the whole nine yards, they all start attacking him because in their mind, this isn't Peter Parker. This is just somebody with the powers of Spider-Man masquerading as Spider-Man. And so the fight goes exactly as we would expect it to, in the sense of the Avengers and everybody is like, hey man, you gotta go. You gotta get out of here. If you really are Spider-Man, you need to leave because all you're doing right now is you're getting in the way. Now, what also ends up happening here is that with Carly Cooper fighting on the front lines and going against, you know, some of these criminals, fighting the small time guys, not really facing off against villains, Peter Parker ends up running into Mary Jane Watson. Now, the cool thing about this is, remember, Mary Jane Watson knows that he's Spider-Man. She's one of the few people that know his identity. And her response is, you have to get out there and you have to do something. Well, in the mind of Peter Parker, he's like, well, all the superheroes don't know that I'm Spider-Man. I can't just walk out and unmask myself. But he says, what I can do is I can rally the citizens of New York. Now, this is extremely important. And the reason why is because Peter Parker goes on camera, broadcasts to the internet and says, hey, if you guys are watching this, I have spider powers. I have a spider sense. I have all these different things. The New York that people believe they know is not the New York that it actually is. People think that everybody in New York are dicks. That's not true. You know, there are people in New York who are hard workers who believe in truth and fairness and justice in the American way. If you're one of those people, fight alongside me, be a superhero. And he basically rallies a whole ton of New Yorkers to his side. Now, this is actually kind of a cool revelation because this will be extremely important once we get back to the end of this video. But following this, you know, where Peter Parker is able to rally these guys to his cause, the next step is, okay, how do we cure this virus? How do we basically eliminate this entire, you know, this pathogen that's giving everybody superpowers? Now, the cool thing is that there are three individuals who are working diligently on this. Max Modell, the head of Horizon Labs, Reed Richards, and some unknown guy in cell number 6. We don't know who that person is, but the cool idea is that with Reed Richards and Max Modell here, if anybody can find a solution, they can. Now, that's kind of the ironic thing about this, is because what Dan Slott does is he says, hey, look, you've got two of the smartest men in the world, like Max Modell and Reed Richards, working on a solution. Surely they're going to find a way to cure this, right? And it's like, well, yeah, I mean, I assume they are. You know, that's something that would make sense. Well, then we shift over to Anti-Venom. Anti-Venom is a ready-made cure. Remember, Anti-Venom is basically a Venom symbiote with antibodies. He can cure any one of anything. And so he begins going through and basically chasing down all these individuals who have spider powers, whether they're villains or whether they're good guys, and starts stripping their abilities away from them, starts taking their abilities away from each and every one of these guys. And it creates kind of a funny situation because in our mind, it would be like, well, I mean, why don't they just go to Anti-Venom? If he's the cure, why don't they just go to Anti-Venom? And so at this point, we end up joining Peter Parker when he and Carly Cooper end up traveling again to the police precinct. Because remember, that's one of the reasons why we covered a lot of these stories with Amazing Spider-Man. A lot of them seemed almost totally irrelevant, and most of them were. But there were little moments here and there that would make sense. When we talked about the return of Wraith, we had talked about how, you know, this one particular police officer was basically breaking into the evidence room and stealing gadgets and equipment that belonged to villains. Well, that's the same room that Carly Cooper and Peter Parker go to. And what Peter Parker does is he says, hey, look, here are a lot of the things that you can use. Because remember, the webbing that Carly Cooper is using is organic webbing. But what she needs is she needs fluids and she needs starchier foods. But she doesn't know this. Peter Parker's just like, hey, here's everything you need in order to get your webbing back. But until that webbing begins to get back to its full supply, here's some artificial, you know, web shooters that will serve the purpose. Not only that, we end up picking up with Project Rebirth in the Catskill Mountains. Now, for those of you guys who are following Comic Storian's channel, this is the whole Agent Venom aspect of Spider Island. I imagine Benny probably covered that in his videos. I'm not sure. I haven't had a chance to watch him yet. I never watch Comic Storian's videos, but... But it creates kind of a funny thing because, again, this shows how large everything goes in the sense that Spider King, you know, this giant spider monster that had popped up earlier in the story, was basically sent on a mission to Project Rebirth. Now, of course, running into Agent Venom, what it does is it bolsters things out a little bit. It basically increases this entire landscape because this adds to the possibility of this infection spreading beyond the borders of New York. And so that's what happens. Mayor J. Jonah Jameson begins to realize that things are becoming more dangerous, that if this infection escapes the island, that these millions of people in Manhattan who all have spider powers will turn into hundreds of millions of people across the United States and eventually billions across the globe if they do not keep it contained. And so in conjunction, you know, with these mandroid suits, basically these mech suits that are used by the NYPD, along with a handful of the Avengers, Luke Cage, and so on, they basically begin the process of blocking off access to New York. They literally start shutting it all down. They start shutting down bridges, shutting down tunnels, the whole nine yards. They quite literally quarantine the entirety of New York. Hence the reason why it's called Spider Island, because everybody on the island of Manhattan has spider powers. And so at this point is the question of how do they bring this down? How do they bring this to an end? Well, of course, the first step is to basically synthesize a cure, which of course Reed Richards and Max Modell are successfully able to do. The issue is who do they give it to? And so what they had to do is they had to develop a device. And the reason why is because there's only a limited amount of the vaccine. Considering the fact that it had to be made quick, fast, and in a hurry, they need a limited quantity so they can test it. If it works, they can mass produce it. What they end up doing is they end up intending to basically analyze different individuals to test them for this strain to see whether or not they have this Spider Island virus. And it turns out that J. Jonah Jameson has it. J. Jonah Jameson basically becomes Spider-Man. And so what we get are all these different situations that kind of roll on top of one another, in the sense that we end up having Anti-Venom, who's going through, just running through Manhattan, curing everybody of this Spider Island virus that he comes across. But we also have the Avengers, the Mighty Avengers, all these individuals putting these sonic pulses around the city of New York that would operate as these kind of psychic fences, so to speak, so that individuals can't leave. They basically can't walk out. It'll end up messing with them, it'll operate as a fence of sorts, and they'll basically end up kind of staying corralled in New York proper. And so what we end up doing is we join with Spider-Man and we join with Carly Cooper when they arrive at a bank robbery. And that's kind of the cool thing here. That's one of the reasons why I like this, is because it's kind of Dan Slott showing us all these different things that all happen at the same time, right? I mean, you have like the Avengers, you have the Mighty Avengers, you have New Avengers, the whole nine yards, all these different superhero teams, you know, trying to corral this massive infection. You've got Reed Richards, you got Max Modell, the Future Foundation, all working on a cure. And then you've got Spider-Man doing what he's always done, trying to keep things at bay. And stories like major crossover events that involve Spider-Man usually always work this way, unless we're talking about an event that takes, you know, that goes off into space or something like that, or threatens the entirety of the Earth at one time, which is to say, like a villain shows up and it's just a threat to the world. Instead of starting out small like the city of Manhattan and working their way out, Spider-Man usually always plays a smaller role. During the Onslaught saga, for example, Spider-Man wasn't really facing off against Onslaught per se. Spider-Man was facing off against a lot of the sentinels that Onslaught was using keep Manhattan in a state of prison. He was fighting off against various villains that were using the chaos as a chance to implement a whole bunch of their own schemes and crimes. And so it was really cool to see a lot of these things take place yet again in the realm of Spider-Man, which is one of the reasons why a lot of fans love him, because Spider-Man is basically Marvel's way of reminding us that the small guy still has issues of their own, and Spider-Man is still looking out for the small guy. This little bit becomes particularly important when we deal with the arrival of the Shocker. And the reason why is because the Shocker, as he exists here, basically has six arms. And our question is, what in the hell happened? Why does the Shocker have six arms? Well, this is when we start getting into the idea of a second phase of this infection, in the sense that individuals who were exposed to the first phase develop Spider-Man powers. When it gets to the second phase, they start physically mutating. And that's what happened with Shocker. When he was infected, his body began to physically mutate. It gave him six arms. It began to mutate him into an actual spider. Now, what Dan Slott's doing here is he's drawing on the Spider-Man element of Infinity War. For those of you guys who don't know, during the Infinity War story arc, when Adam Warlock's evil persona, Magus, was trying to attain the Infinity Gauntlet by grabbing all the different cosmic cubes from different universes, what Magus ended up doing was creating doppelgangers for the Earth's heroes in order to keep them out of the way. And so where you had like a Wolverine doppelganger, you had a Reed Richards doppelganger, a Hulk doppelganger, so on and so forth, Spider-Man had his doppelganger, which had six arms. The issue is that doppelganger became so popular that Marvel kind of had to roll him over into after the events of Infinity War were done, because people loved that idea. The issue is that nobody could write him very well. So eventually they got rid of him. But what we end up doing is we basically start picking up with all these different mutations. And this is when we learn who this individual is. This is when we learn who this unknown woman is, that she's basically someone called the Queen. Now, for those of you guys who don't know, the Queen is a woman named Adriana Soria, I think it is. And she first appeared in Spectacular Spider-Man Volume 2, number 15, I think. She was a character that was created for the purpose of kind of stepping into this new era of Peter Parker, where Marvel was trying to kind of switch things around, move things around, make him a little more interesting. It was that whole hodgepodge of events leading into One More Day. But it was this idea that she was basically someone who had the ability or had telepathy and basically had what was called the insect gene. And what that meant was that she was able to tap into and control individuals and insects, but the only individuals she could control were people who had insect genes. The problem with this was that her being able to control them was contingent on her knowing that they were people with insect genes. And so the reason behind this whole thing, this entire Spider Island event, was for her to basically engineer her own kingdom. Now, it's not the first time she's tried this. During that whole weird era of Spider-Man, there was a point where Peter Parker actually turned into a giant spider. It was weird as hell. But the whole notion was that she had tried to kind of create a hive for herself in the sense that she had tried to take over New York. Ultimately, she was defeated. But in the instance where Peter Parker turned into a giant spider and then eventually was transformed back, she had taken a husk, a little form, a little piece of this gene for Peter. She had taken it to Miles Warren, to the Jackal, and that's what Jackal used to synthesize, or I guess to create this virus planted in these bedbugs and turn the citizens of New York into individuals with the powers of Spider-Man. And so what this would allow the Queen to do is then turn around and control those individuals because now they all have an insect gene. And so because of this, what her intention is to literally just kind of create her own army. And that's exactly what's happening with these secondary mutations. All these people who are beginning to mutate are turning into giant spiders. That's literally what they are. They're just turning into massive spiders. But this is going to allow the Queen to basically begin the process of engineering her own kingdom, to basically create her own place of rule. Now, the other cool thing about this is that we actually end up joining Anti-Venom. And this is kind of the funny situation here because there's a mishmash of things at work here. There's a mishmash of plays going on all at the same time in the sense that with Spider-King having been, gone against Agent Venom, that when Spider-King returns to the Queen as well as Miles Warren, this is not actually Spider-King. Instead, this is Agent Venom posing as Spider-King. And that's why this is one of those cool things, is because it's the ability of Agent Venom to use the Venom symbiote to kind of shapeshift, to adjust himself. That's one of the reasons why a lot of people love Agent Venom, because it was taking the Venom symbiote and using it in a way that hadn't really been used before. But in addition to all of this, these individuals who are beginning to physically manifest, who are beginning to physically mutate, actually end up going to Our Lady of Saints Church and grabbing Anti-Venom. And the reason why is because word has reached their ears that Anti-Venom has the ability to cure people of their infection. Now, this is why we did the whole thing of of Anti-Venom and the Punisher team up, the Amazing Spider-Man and Anti-Venom team up, the origin of Anti-Venom, because this was Dan Slott bringing this redemption of Eddie Brock into full view, basically bringing it all the way back around again. It was Dan Slott saying, hey, look, this is why Eddie Brock is basically a good guy. It's him trying to do the right thing, because he looks at all these individuals and he says, you poor cast off souls, come to Papa Anti-Venom. I have the cure to what ails you. And it's basically him curing people. It's him saying, look, I'm a good guy. I'm curing every last one of these individuals. I'm literally saving New York. Now that'll become a lot more important than it seems right now, but it's a really, really interesting set of events, because for Peter Parker, for Spider-Man himself, it's absolute pandemonium and it's chaos, because among all these giant spiders are Carly Cooper. Now, while he's trying to track her down, while he's trying to stop these giant spiders that are attacking individuals, one of them basically begins to lay waste to the vehicle or to the motorcade of J. Jonah Jameson. And this is kind of cool, because what happens is Jameson refuses to be saved by Peter Parker yet again. Keep in mind, Jameson has always housed a hatred for Peter Parker, but in Jameson's mind, the death of his wife Marla is tied into Peter Parker's actions. And of course, Marla told him in her final moments, do not succumb to hate. Do not blame Spider-Man. Do not blame Alistair Smythe, Spider-Slater. Do not blame any of those. Just accept the fact that sometimes things like this happen and there's nothing we can really do to stop it. And so what ends up happening here is that in the midst of all this, J. Jonah Jameson reveals the fact that he has spider powers. He grabs Peter Parker and he says, we're going back to the emergency command center. We're going to find a way to get over this. I think I have an ace in the hole. Now this is kind of cool, because this is an uneasy alliance between J. Jonah Jameson and Spider-Man. If it was Jameson's way, he'd just throw Spider-Man in jail and call it a day. But he needs Spider-Man. He needs Spider-Man here because he's basically the only individual present in New York that has spider powers that can use them effectively. Everybody else that has spider powers are turning into giant spider monsters. And so what we do is we pick up with J. Jonah Jameson basically interrogating Alistair Smith. And Smith is a little cryptic here, because first of all, he says, look, man, the whole reason why I'm Spider Slayer is because you and your stupid tabloid led to the death of my father. They led to the destruction of my career. They led to me becoming a bad guy. All I want is revenge on you. But then it's also Alistair Smith saying, hey, I got my revenge, because this is when he realizes the only reason J. Jonah Jameson would come to him after Smith killed Jameson's wife is because Jameson himself is infected. And so it's like Alistair Smith getting the revenge that he always wanted. Now, this comes to bear, this little bit of hubris on Smith's behalf comes to bear when the Queen begins to use her telepathy and start talking to J. Jonah Jameson, begins to infiltrate his mind, and she basically appears as the wife of J. Jonah Jameson and says, remember how I told you not to blame yourself, how I told you not to blame Spider-Man, don't blame and Alistair Smith, I lied. Kill them all. And so it's so cool because then J. Jonah Jameson starts to lose his mind. Now, again, we get a little bit more of this kind of a montage, this little bit of a hodgepodge where we have Black Cat and we have a few of the ground level heroes really trying to protect some of these sonic devices for the purpose of keeping everybody corralled in New York. We have Agent Venom going against Anti-Venom, which is actually pretty amazing. Like, it's pretty badass. We also end up having Mary Jane Watson develop spider powers on her own. And so because of this, we ultimately pick up with Agent Venom having defeated Anti-Venom. As far as I'm aware, we don't see it, but it may end up being that that's part of the Venom tie-in. I'll have to double check on that, but Anti-Venom is essentially defeated here. Now, the irony of all this is that Agent Venom didn't ask any questions. He just showed up and started attacking Anti-Venom and was just like, you're coming with me. And it's kind of funny because when Anti-Venom, when Eddie Brock is talking to Reed Richards, you know, he's like, hey, look, I would have come willingly. All you had to do was tell me what it is that you wanted. If what you wanted was to basically use me as a way to synthesize a cure, then I would have been fine with that. And Reed Richards says, well, I'm glad you're on board, man, because we're literally taking the entire Anti-Venom symbiote. And Eddie Brock's response is like, what? And he's like, yeah, man, you're not going to be able to be Anti-Venom anymore. Now, keep in mind, this is Dan Slott kind of wrapping this up. This is Dan Slott saying, hey, guys, look, for the time being, at least as far as I'm aware, for the time being, this is the beginning and the end of Anti-Venom. It's kind of wrapping these things up, sort of bringing things to a close. Because remember, the entire Anti-Venom arc was designed for the sole purpose of redeeming Eddie Brock in the eyes of comic book fans, in the eyes of really, you know, the superhero landscape within Marvel Comics itself. Now, of course, with J. Jonah Jameson, you know, mutating, freaking out, under the influence of the Queen, he immediately attacks Alistair Smythe. And in his last couple seconds, you know, with the last few seconds of life that he has left, Alistair Smythe says, you have everything you need to defeat these giant spiders. You already have your army. All you have to do is figure out a way to tap into it and use it for your own ends. With that being said, guys, we're gonna bring this video to an end. Them cliffhangers, though, but we've gone on long enough. We're gonna bring this video to an end. If you guys are new here to Comics Explained, you guys enjoy this video, make sure you hit the sub button and become part of the Rob Corps. If you guys dug this, make sure you hit that like button, man. Smash that like button. Like button, smash, Hulk smash. I don't know. Anyway, leave a comment down below. Let me know what you guys think about Spider Island, because I love Spider Island. It's such a fun story. And yeah, I will catch you guys later. Peace.